Blackstone Audio presents
Follow Me Down by Shelby Foote. Enter a doctor. Malcolm, comes the king forth, I pray you? Doctor, aye, sir, there are a crew of wretched souls that stay his cure. Their malady convinces the great assay of art. But at his touch, such sanctity hath heaven given his hand, they presently amend. Exit. Malcolm, I thank you, doctor. Macduff, what's the disease he means? Malcolm, 'tis called the evil. Macbeth, Act 4, Scene 3. Part 1, Chapter 1, Circuit Clerk. Generally, the first week in September brings the hottest weather of the year, and this was no exception. Overhead, the fans turn slow. Their paddle blades stir in the air up close to the ceiling, but nowhere else. They made a steady squeaking sound, monotonous. You heard it for maybe the first 10 minutes and then didn't hear it at all unless you remembered and tried. Above the rows of town and country men and women in shirt sleeves and calico, and above the smattering of Negroes in the balcony with their high-boiled collars and watch chains. The country women, friends and relatives of Eustace and Old Man Lundy, held cardboard fans, cardooey and tuberose snuff, gone limp by now and mostly frayed at the edges, for this was the fourth day. It was over now, all but the verdict. Judge Holloman was instructing the jury, an old man with wattles like a turkey cock, 10 years older than anyone else in the courtroom, talking around the stem of a bulldog pipe you'd think he got at Yale in 96, except he never went to any college, let alone up east. He used a box of kitchen matches a day to keep it lighted, hawking and spitting into the chamber pot that sat beside and just to the rear of his chair in a litter of broken match stems matting thicker and thicker all morning, so that by afternoon, if you came upon him from the rear, the soles of your shoes wouldn't touch the floor. I never saw him strike one without breaking it. The whole right half of the bench was scored and crisscrossed with scratches that probably had a phosphor gleam at night. He always took aim at the pot, but I've yet to see one go in, even by accident, though he never missed it spitting. Once, somebody asked him, "Why don't you retire?" And he'd look back at them, glaring down from the height of all those bachelor years. "Retire," he says, "I am retired. I'm clean away from this world and sitting in judgment on it." Hawk spit. Frank James died in his arms out west, he told me once. He, the judge, not Jesse's brother, though maybe there is something in that too, he liked to watch their faces when he gave it to them. I think the man he hated most in all this world was Parker Noel, who had robbed him of so many. But wait, I'll get to Eustace. As for Eustace, he put you in mind of an owl from the minute you saw him. Horn-rimmed glasses, sharp little beak of a nose, a tuft of hair on each side of his forehead. You more or less expected him to turn his head on the top of his neck and blink his eyes and say, "Who?" Point of fact, he never said anything at all, except maybe a word or two behind his hand to Noel while somebody was running him down on the stand. Beulah, the dead girl's mother, for instance. He sat removed, showing the jury how crazy he was or how crafty. Nobody blamed him, considering what hung in the balance was a seat in the old shocking chair and a trip to the big beyond, where every imp in hell had polished the tines of his pitchfork shiny bright and old Satan himself was planning to handle the damper. He played it just right. Not too much, not too little. Just right, the way Parker Noel had coached him. You almost had to respect him, except then you'd remember that girl and the 3 days she spent in the lake, food for the shrimps and gars, and he was the one who put her there and had planned it in advance. I swore him in. I have sworn in a many one in my time, being circuit clerk these past 6 years. I've seen them all kinds, tall and short, jumpy and confident. You swear the testimony you are about to give in this case will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God? And some were sheepish, reaching out for the book the way a man would reach out to touch a stove lid to see if it's hot, while others blustered, clapping their hands on it like they were glad of a chance to show how forthright and upstanding they were, glad of a chance to speak their piece in the sight of God and everybody. These were the most outlandish liars of all. But Eustace, He stood blinking and listening while I rattled it off, just his fingertips touching the leather. And when I finished, he bent forward all of a sudden, like there was a spring in his backbone, and kissed it. I had an impulse to jerk back on the Bible, but almost before I knew what had happened, he was standing up straight and blinking at me again. Parker Noel hadn't moved a muscle in his face. I could see him out of the tail of my eye, and I wondered if he had coached him. Eustace stood there. "Do you?" I said, but he just stood there. "Do you?" I said again. "Do I what?" he says. So I had to run through it again, keeping a firm grip on the book, ready to jerk it back in case he tried a repeat on the kissing act. "I do," he says real solemn. His voice was low. The first I heard of all this was a Friday morning.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.